In the previous video, we covered how FaceRobot goes about deforming a character's head. In this video, we'll run through the solving process so that our zombie head is ready for animation. Load the FR Part 2 start scene, which contains the zombie head where we left it at the end of Stage 1. Note that this scene was saved with FaceRobot enabled. When you load it, SoftImage will enable FaceRobot mode if you haven't already done so. Click the Pick Objects button to go to Stage 2. Here, you need to identify the parts of the head so that FaceRobot knows which objects to use in its calculations. If you make a mistake, just click the Face Parts icon in the panel and then repick that part in the viewport. The tongue is the only part that isn't mandatory, which means you can still solve the head without it. But since we have one, we'll get much more convincing results when we tackle lip syncing in a later video. If you take a look at the Explorer, you'll notice that the parts you picked have been moved from the zombie model into the actor node in the FaceRobot model. Once you're done, click Assemble. This brings you back to Stage 1. FaceRobot automatically runs a diagnosis on the objects you just picked and lets you know if your head model is ready to proceed to Stage 3. This diagnosis basically makes sure that the modeling requirements we covered in the previous video have been met. Any errors detected are listed in the log and must be dealt with before going further. To fix some of the most common problems, such as holes left open or an animated head not yet frozen, click these buttons above the log. Note that freezing the animation happens at the current frame, so it's best that you pick a frame that represents your character in its default state. FaceRobot is now ready to scan our zombie head. As the log indicates, scanning freezes the modeling stack for each object, effectively preventing you from making changes to the head's topology, such as by inserting new edge loops or adding and deleting points. If you're solving a head for the first time, now is a good time to save your scene so that you can get back to it if need be. Click Scan to go to Stage 3. In this stage, you pick landmarks at specific locations throughout the head. Landmarks are markers that FaceRobot uses to map out the head's size and facial proportions. Using the images in the panel as a reference, click on your model to place each of the landmarks. To undo the last landmark placement, middle-click anywhere on screen. If you wish to start over instead, right-click anywhere and then click Reset. As a general rule, you'll want to place these landmarks properly to give the best deformation results later on, especially in the mouth corners, which are a bit more sensitive. Because we previously set our DNA type as symmetrical, FaceRobot automatically places a landmark on the other side of the head, too. Once all the landmarks are in place, click Fit to proceed to Stage 4. Based on the landmark information, FaceRobot analyzes the skull geometry and creates a soft tissue model that fits onto it. This soft tissue model consists of deformers that describe the facial anatomy and determine how the face deforms when it's animated. What you see in Stage 4 is the result of those calculations. Since the soft tissue model is not directly accessible, FaceRobot creates a set of controls and curves that you can use to fine-tune it. The amount of tweaking required depends on the specifics of your head's proportions and on how you place the landmarks on it. That said, here are some things to keep in mind. When adjusting the eyes, make sure that the centers of the red spheres line up to match each eye in position and rotation. The four curves define the boundaries of the jaw deformers. In other words, the part of the mesh that's within those curves will be affected when the zombie's jaw opens, closes, and rolls around, so it's important to ensure that these curves follow the face as accurately as possible. Move the controls on the left side of the face to adjust them with symmetry. or move them on the right to affect only that side. As for the jaw itself, move the controls so that they match the chin, jaw corner, and near the ear. The neck curve can be considered optional based on whether or not you plan to animate the head's rotation or position in Face Robot. If that's the case, you'll want to place the top neck control where the skull meets the top vertebra, and the bottom control should be where the neck meets the body. In our case, we won't make use of them since we plan to recombine the head with the body and could use a skeleton rig to drive both the body and head's animation. The tongue uses four nulls that are not currently matching the shape of the tongue. Reposition them so that each null goes to its correct home inside the tongue mesh: the tip, front, back, and tongue base. You can also inspect the ear clusters to make sure that all their points are contained within the ears. Lastly, choose the type of animation that you'll be doing. Keyframe will make the head follow the neck when you animate the head controller, while motion capture is the opposite, meaning that the neck follows the head, which is what we'll be doing. Click Solve to finalize the solving process. Based on the fitting you just did, Face Robot processes the soft tissue model and generates a control rig that will drive the deformations on the face. The time it takes to solve a head is based on the mesh density. The more points to compute, the longer it'll take. When it's done, you're at Stage 5, which features our newly solved zombie head driven by his very own facial animation rig. Save your scene at this point in case you want to come back to it. In the next video, we'll test our solved head for problems and get into some tuning workflows to fix them.